रामाय रामभद्राय रामचंद्राय वेदसे रघुनाथाय नाथाय सीताय प्रतये नमः. अयोध्या कांड चैप्टर नंबर 85 गुहा'स डाउट्स डिस्पेल्ड. द रेसिटेशन इज एज बिलो. एंड भरता गिव मीट रिप्लाई. Dear friend of Sri Rama, my master and guru, my troops are very numerous and you have no one to assist you, yet you would entertain them hospitably. Well, I take the vow of the deed and am as pleased. His noble heart rejoiced at having met Kuha, and at the very kind welcome he offered him, he almost imagined his heart hopes fulfilled. Let be, he cried. Show me the way to the hermitage of Maharishi Bharadwaja. I take it that traveling through the swamps and marshes along the banks of River Ganga is no child's play. But Guha, who was born and bred in those woods, hastened to assure him. My hunters and I go with you armed, so you need not waste a thought on the difficulties of the roads that you have to travel along. But the sight of this vast army fills me with dread and suspicion. Do you call yourself a friend to Rama or an enemy? No one fears him, then why this countless army? He clasped earnest hands of appeal to emphasize his humble request. But there was not the slightest necessity for Guha to suspect Bharata. The pure Akasha is not defiled in the least by the dirt we may throw at it. We but soil our hands thereby. Even so, Bharata, whose pure soul was filled with utmost devotion to Rama, felt not a shadow of anger at Guha, who doubted him all causelessly. Grant me, he said, the favor that the time may never come for your suspicions about me to be realized. You do but ill to doubt me. Rama is my elder brother. He is as father to me. I go to take him back to Ayodhya, where his crown and his countless millions await his arrival. Mistake me not. I speak the truth. Guha's face shone with joy as he exclaimed, Lord, so you have decided to forgo the crown that came to you unasked and without any effort on your part. You stand alone in this world and unparalleled for your altruism and magnanimity. Perfect you are, any way I take you. Eternal fame is yours in all the worlds if you succeed in persuading Rama to take the crown back. And upon them, thus conversing, the sun went down. They camped there for that night, and a woeful night it was for Bharata. Born in the lap of luxury and comfort, a stranger to sorrow and suffering, utterly unmeet to experience either, he was all guiltless of anything that might entail upon him such misery. Filled with boundless devotion to Rama, and possessed of a courage and fortitude that no danger nor adversity could weaken, yet he was in the mighty grip of some affliction that defied speech and thought. Rama occupied his mind, his heart, and his soul, and his whole being blazed with a quenchless fire when he dwelt upon the injustice and harm that his brother had at his hands, even as a forest tree glows at its heart with an invisible fire. Perspiration ran from his body, scorched with grief. Even as the burning rays of the sun melt the Himalayan snow into roaring torrents, separation from the sight of Rama was like unto a lofty mountain. The ceaseless flow of thought about him formed the rocks that made it up, the varied sighs of the veins of gold and silver that run around it. The paralyzed senses are the inanimate trees that covered it. Grief and weariness are its peaks. The frequent fits of unconsciousness were the cruel beasts that roamed through the forests. Its fiery energy was the dense bamboo groves that lines its side. And as an elephant separated from its herd, Bharata suffered in speechless agony, his sorrow-laden heart heaving grievous sighs, fainting oft and more than once on the brink of death. Then he naturally repaired with his attendants to where Guha lay, who, grieved to see him grieve, set about to console him. Mangalam Koshalendraya Mahaniya Gunabdeye Chakravarti Dhanurjaya Sarva Bhaumaya Mangalam.